There are plenty to see around Verdun in France, but its most significant role was militaristic, and it occurred during World War I. The Battle of Verdun, which happened between February 21st to December 18, 1916, was a World War I engagement in which the French repulsed a major German offensive. It was one of the longest, bloodiest, and most ferocious battles of the war. French casualties amounted to about 400,000, while Germany has about 350,000. Around 300,000 were killed. The Prelude. It all started when German General Erich von Falkenhayn believed that the war would be won or lost in France, and he felt that the strategy of attrition was Germany's best hope for achieving its goals. Falkenhayn believed that Britain was the most formidable of the Allied powers. He regarded Russia as already paralyzed and Italy as unlikely to affect the outcome of the war, concluding only France remains, and that Germany should bleed France to death by choosing a point of attack. The fortress of Verdun, with its surrounding fortifications along the Meuse River, was selected because it threatened the main German communication lines. It represented a salient in the French defenses, and the loss of such citadel would be an enormous blow to French morale. The keynote of the tactical plan was a continuous series of limited advances that would draw the French reserves into the mincing machine of the German artillery. Local command of the operation was given to Crown Prince Wilhelm, the eldest son of the Kaiser. The initial German attack. As early as January 1916, French airmen had detected German preparations, and on February 11, a French intelligence officer discovered a buildup of German troops on the right bank of the Meuse. The French commanders had been almost exclusively focused on their own offensive plans. Their hasty efforts to bolster the defenses of Verdun were very nearly too late. Over the next 10 days, thousands of men and dozens of guns were moved to Verdun to oppose the expected German attack. French officers organized a motorized supply chain on an unprecedented scale, transporting men and material to the front in a fleet of more than 3,000 trucks. The 37-mile or 57-kilometer dirt road connecting the railhead of Bar-le-Duc to Verdun came to be known as La Voie Sacrée, or the Sacred Way, for its critical role in the French defense. On February 21st, the Germans commenced a massive bombardment and infantry attack. By the end of the first day, they made significant gains, penetrating the French lines. The following day, they capitalized on their gains, repelling a French counterattack. The village of Humo was razed by artillery fire, and in 3 days, the Germans had overrun the first line of French defenses, and both sides hastily reinforced their positions. The rest of the German line swept through the second rank of defenses, capturing villages and estates while advancing on the key fort at Douaumont. That evening, the French commander of Verdun, General Joseph Jacques César Joffe, was set aside in favor of General Philippe Pétain. Pétain brought a fresh army to the fight, and the French High Command soon decreed that a new defensive line should be held at all costs. As the French defense was reorganized, the Germans captured the undefended Fort Douaumont, arguably the most formidable of the strongholds surrounding Verdun. French resistance stiffened over subsequent days, however, and the German advance slowed down. The second phase of the battle. The Germans had failed to gain an immediate victory, that they soon realized that the British army was preparing an attack on the Somme. For its part, the French general staff held on at Verdun without ceasing to prepare for the Somme, exhausting the Germans as much as possible in advance of the planned Allied summer offensive. On March 4th, the Germans captured Dumont village. The town was razed during the battle, ensuring that it could not be rebuilt. On March 10th, the Germans cleared the way to a hill known as Limorheim. Both sides suffered tens of thousands of casualties during these furious engagements, and on March 14th, the Germans captured the lower crest of the Limorheim. The higher crest could not be held by either side and was considered no man's land. The Germans spent the next couple of days engaging in a series of bloody but inconclusive attacks on the fort and village of Vaux, and captured it on March 31st. By April 8th, the French had lost all that remained of their former front line on the left bank of the Meuse. The bloody stalemate continued through April as both armies rotated their commanding officers. Petain was promoted to commander of Army Group Center, and his former command was divided, with Robert-Georges Nivelle taking charge of the French forces on the right bank and Henri Berthelot leading the defense on the left. The German command had also divided the field of battle into two sections, with General Ewald von Lacroix replacing General Bruno von Mudra on the right bank. General Max von Galwitz commanded the left bank until he was replaced by General Hermann von Francois in July. As each army continued to seek the advantage at Verdun, preparations for the Somme offensive asserted pressure on both sides to push for a hasty and conclusive resolution to the battle. After days of back and forth combat, the Germans captured both positions on June 9th, but they were unable to carry their attack due to defensive works south of Chaumont. Fighting was largely inconclusive. But on June 15th, the French reclaimed roughly a little more than a half mile, just 1 kilometer of trenches. Such minor gains, which come at an enormous cost in lives, would amplify the horrors of trench warfare on the Western Front. While the Germans retained the initiative at Verdun, their efforts were frustrated when they were forced to divert attention to the Eastern Front, when victory at Verdun was imminent. The Germans renewed their attack on June 21st. As more French towns fell, the situation had become so dire for the French that Petain, a sector commander, advised relocating to the left bank if the Germans advanced farther. On June 27, he was ordered to hold the right bank at all costs. The tide turns at Verdun. The preliminaries of the great Franco-British offensive on the Somme started on June 24th with a week-long artillery barrage. On July 11th, the Germans made yet another attack on Verdun and another attack on August 1st, but both failed, while the French started retaking towns and villages. Local fighting continued throughout the month, and the final significant German attack on September 3rd yielded no gains. With that, the active period of the Battle of Verdun came to an end. By December 1916, roughly 75% of the French army had seen action on the Meuse. From February through July, the Germans had used 43 divisions. French guns at Verdun fired over 10 million rounds with the field artillery, over 1 million medium caliber rounds and 600,000 large caliber rounds. At the conclusion of this enormous expenditure of blood and resources, the lines were little changed from where they had been in early February. In September 1916, General Charles Mangin proposed a scheme to liberate the Verdun region. An offensive was initiated on October 21st with an artillery barrage across a broad front. An infantry assault followed on October 24th. By that evening, the French had retaken Douaumont along with 6,000 German prisoners, and by November 2nd, the fort at Vaux was once again in French hands. In order to exploit his successes, Mangin planned to attack again on December 5th with the intention of retaking in one blow the whole of the former 2nd French line, which had been lost on February 24th. French and German batteries engaged in artillery duels, and above the battlefield, pilots contested for supremacy of the skies. On December 15th, the attack occurred with the Germans starting late, and by nightfall, the French had retaken the whole Fauve Hill. This engagement, which came to be known as the Battle of Plumont, was completed on December 18th with the capture of over 11,000 German prisoners. This finally marked the end of the Battle of Verdun. The aftermath. Over 10 months in 1916, the two armies at Verdun suffered over 700,000 casualties, including some 300,000 killed. The pastoral landscape surrounding the city had been permanently transformed, and 9 villages were entirely destroyed. After the war, the villages were memorialized as having died for France, and although uninhabited, continued to be administered by mayors to preserve their existence as administrative entities. The unknown dead were commemorated at the Douaumont ossuary, a monument completed in 1932 that contains the remains of 150,000 unidentified French and German soldiers. An area covering some 65 square miles on Verdun Ridge was declared a zone rouge or red zone because of the presence of an exploded ordnance, and development within it was prohibited. In the 21st century, the French Interior Ministry estimated that over 10 million shells remained in the soil around Verdun. The bomb clearing units continued to remove some 40 tons of unexploded munitions from the area annually. It was estimated that at existing rates of clearance, the deminers will be uncovering and disposing of ordnance in the Verdun area for centuries to come. There are plenty of sites to see in Verdun, but according to their brochure, there are 5 main sites that are worth seeing. The Memorial of Verdun. The memorial transmits the history behind the Battle of Verdun and their fighters, the French and Germans. 2,000 memorabilia and objects from both sides and testimonials and exceptional audio devices mingles to recall the fighting experience of these men. Douaumont Ossuary. It is the resting place of the unidentified remains of around 130,000 French and German soldiers, collected from the chaotic battlefield, devastated by 51 months of appalling war. This iconic monument is the symbol of the Franco-German reconciliation, sealed by the handshake between Mitterrand and Kohl in September 1984. Fort de Douaumont. It is the vault key of the fortified system of Verdun. Fort Douaumont was taken by German army within the first days of the Battle of Verdun. In February 1916, it was occupied for 8 months until it was retaken on on October 24, 1916 after a bitter fight. Fort Devaux. Between March and June 1916, Fort Devaux was bombed by almost 8,000 shells a day. Its isolated garrison resisted the lead heroic battles before having to surrender due to the exhaustion of its armed forces. It then became the symbol of resistance of the Verdun soldiers. The Citadel of Verdun. It is in this citadel that in November 10, 1920, that took place the choice of the unknown soldier who lies beneath the Arc de Triomphe. This unknown soldier symbolizes the sacrifice of all the unidentified soldiers, or those lost. You can also discover the everyday life of home front soldiers thanks to the film animations and the constitutions. So that's it for the history of the Battle of Verdun, its importance.
The five historical places we visited. I hope you guys learned a lot. Until next time. Bye.
So guys, if you like our videos, please subscribe to our channel and feel free to comment.
Hit the bell, come on guys, hit the bell!
For notifications!
And don't forget to share!
And like!